have a good connection where I am. Today it's an unfortunate situation. So as I was saying, this girl belong to the city of one of you. She was an orphan. She was orphaned by his family of 2005 to 2006, something like that. Her parents died, and in the aftermath, her own family, extended family, rejected her. After the tsunami, there was so much of suffering among the coastal population, so much of exploitation, that at that time, when these two kids were rejected, somebody brought them to this city, and there they grew up, just Rani and her younger brother. As if that was not enough, at the age of 16, she got osteosarcoma. Let me tell you how we heard about it. Rani was in a very big hospital, reputed to be one of the best medical colleges in the whole country. They decided that her condition was too far advanced to be cured. And then this leg was ulcerating and was having maggots. Do you know what happens to people when they get maggots? Hospitals reject them. They are a nuisance. There is foul smell. Your MBBS or BDS and MDS and MD did not possibly teach you how to treat a wound with maggots, how to treat the malodor. It's much, and the other patients in the ward complain. Rani was thrown out. Discharge from medical college hospital is a nice way of saying it. She just was thrown out. She was taken out of the hospital, put in on the pavement outside the hospital, and that was it. A kind man, an alternative medicine doctor, happened to see her. He couldn't just leave her. Hey, this is interesting. Many of you have seen people like this in our own hospitals. I have, as a medical student. Well, not exactly dumped in the payment, though that also happens. But we have seen people in intense suffering. Somehow, our medical education and our degrees enable us to give a pitying look and walk away. Well, this alternative medicine doctor put her in his car in the rear seat with her brother and took her to his consultation room. I told you he was an alternative medicine doctor. To the consultation room and kept her there in a bed. And then he started sending emails to all over the country. We have such a patient. Can somebody help? We also got an email. One of my colleagues actually wanted to get into the next flight, go and bring her to Trivandrum, but that was not an easy practical thing to do. We would have done it. We actually had a plan B to bring her to Trivandrum if necessary. But we talked to a palliative care doctor in one of the medical colleges in Puducherry. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to mention the name of the city. So this doctor inquired and found that this patient had been taken from that doctor's consultation room to a destitute's terminal care home, which was several hours away. The next day was a Sunday. So this doctor and a medical student volunteer took an ambulance, hired an ambulance, traveled to this place and talked to the priest who was running the home. She was stinking. There were maggots and they didn't know what to do with it because they had no significant medical support. This doctor and the medical student talked to her. She was more than willing to go with anybody. They actually had taken oral morphine with them. They started her on morphine. She immediately started calling them Anna, elder brother. She built that relationship very fast. And on the way, she wanted to stop. She had two demands. One, she wanted a panda, wanted an omelette. Anyway, I'll come back to Rani's story later. The most important thing is our medical system refuses to treat people who are inconvenient. You and I were not taught in medical college to treat suffering, to treat pain, to treat suffering. And that is the sad part of healthcare. If anybody has any comments in between, just raise your hand or ask a chat question. I know that my accent may be difficult for some of you, especially for those from Philippines, Indonesia. My accent is very, very Indian or Malaysian. My accent is very, very Indian. Apologies for that. If you have questions, do send chat messages. I would like to. Raju, is my voice still broken or am I clearly audible now?
Now you are, sir. Sometimes it is breaking in between, but it is okay. We can make up the sentence, sir.
Raju, move on to the next slide, please. So, for Rani and for more than 1.5 million of people with cancer and for several millions of people with many other diseases where cure is not possible, the treatment is still disease focused. Though we know that health is what is seen on the screen, our education has not prepared us to deal with that. Next slide, Raju. Of that 1.5 million people with cancer, and for, thank you, Regina, and for many more millions in serious health-related suffering, even basic pain relief is not available. Next. No, that is, Raju, go back. Now, this is what I call an error of omission. This is our duty. The healthcare provider's duty, according to a document CMR, which lays down the doctor's duty of care, is to mitigate suffering. It is to cure sometimes, relieve often, and comfort always. And that we are not be doing. So, this is one error of omission which you will need to correct. But in addition, Raju, there is a major error of commission. What we are doing to the introduction, you particularly mentioned the end of life. Remember, palliative care is not only about end of life. I hope that's clear. Certainly not. We'll come to that. But end of life is particularly horrendous. People who have no money, poor folk, are better off. They also do not get pain relief. They get no health care. Maybe that's a good thing. They at least get some compassion from the family. There is the family is around. We'll talk about end of life care on another day, but we have to remember that this is what we do to dying people in our country. Western countries are not like this. In USA and Europe, things are better. Anywhere from 22 to 36% of people still die on ventilators there, but most of them, majority of dying people have the artificial life support withdrawn. They are given palliative care instead. Here we allow them to die in this fashion, separate from the family, denying them everything that's important to them. This is a major error of commission on the part of the medical system. Next, please. And the next error of commission, I'll let you read that and take it in. Dear doctors, after putting in your 5 or 6 or 8 or 10 years of medical education and post-graduation and everything, see what we are doing to our people. The science that you and I have learned is used to push 4% of our population below the poverty line. That is the second error of commission that I am talking about. So what I have said so far is that medical system has the major error of omission of not treating pain and suffering. What we did to, what they did to Rani, and two major errors of commission: inappropriate end of life care, which causes suffering, and catastrophic health expenditure, destroying families. It is in this background that this course and your future work, our future work together, is going to matter. Next, please. See the title? This is a myth. Palliative care is certainly not only for end of life. Next, please. This is how the World Health Organization defines palliative care. Please note that the definition is 18 years old. A lot of people feel that this needs to be revised. But particularly look at the words that I have shown in red. It's about quality of life. Not only the patient, but also the family. One of you mentions that your father is going through a cancer experience, and you know that you suffer a lot. Every member of the family suffers. Of the participants, some 30 participants, I'm sure there must be 4 or 5 people who have gone through this experience in your own family. And you know that suffering is physical, social, mental, and spiritual. So we are trying to improve the quality of life of patients and families by preventing and treating pain and other physical problems. any symptom, and also psychological, social, and spiritual issues. Identify them, try to prevent them, and treat them. That's palliative care. Raju, and particularly to highlight the point that it is not end of life care, the same definition of 2002 has a footnote which says that palliative care is applicable early in the course of illness in conjunction with other therapies that are intended to prolong life. So even if the treatment is only starting or yet to start, pain or any symptom can still be treated. Patient needs psychosocial support right from the beginning through the treatment. Now, here we have two oncologists in the group. And in a way, as far as cancer treatment is concerned, I would consider they are the most important people, because they will be able to combine their practice with palliative care. And that's the ideal thing to happen. Next, please. Look at the last two lines. Serious health-related suffering. As I said, it is very difficult to remember the WHO definition. But if you try to remember this, maybe we'll all feel so much of peace. Palliative care is about management of serious health-related suffering, for which you need to address all these circles. And please note that every single circle on the screen is encroaching onto the other. Pain causes social, emotional, and spiritual issues also. Pain causes irritability, anger, frustration, death wish, family relationships, and a feeling, why did God desert me? Similarly, each can cause the others. Next, please. Raju. Wait. Back. No, next one. No, not back. Forward. One more. Next one. Ah, that's it. Is it not the next one, Raju? Okay, does it matter? If all these different aspects are to be addressed, why should it be only doctors and nurses? Now, I noticed that one of the 30 people attending or 32 people attending is not a doctor. Lakshmi Nair introduced herself as an observer. Lakshmi, only one part of one circle, the physical part, needs a doctor and a nurse. Most of the people suffering can be looked after by human beings with adequate empowerment and adequate motivation. So Lakshmi, do not please feel an outsider in this group. You are a very important person in this group. We welcome volunteers. Generally, healthcare does not accept volunteers into its sanctum sanctorum. But remember, it was a medical student volunteer whom Rani started calling Anna, her own. She started spontaneously established a relationship. Volunteers, medical, social workers, physiotherapists, pharmacists, they are all part of palliative care. Only thing is, everybody needs training. A layman armed only with compassion cannot come and help unless he understands about illness a little bit, unless he understands what not to do and what to do and how to do. So a team that each one of you develop tomorrow, ideally, would have all these components. Next, please. One, during the course that is to follow, during one or two sessions, or no, three sessions, we'll be dealing with pain in detail. Among the four circles, the physical aspect was mostly about disease and symptoms. Among the symptoms, pain is perhaps the commonest in many advanced illnesses. In 1986, the World Health Organization brought out the WHO analgesic ladder. And fortunately, even today, only 2% of people have access to step 3 of the ladder. Most people do not. This is an error to be repaired. For one thing, each one of you will need to understand pain management properly. We are not going into that. But you all have been treating pain already. Every single doctor and dentist in this group has been treating pain, right? But though in the application of your oncology or pediatrics, you follow evidence-based medicine, so far I suspect that for most of you, the practice of pain management has been based on hearsay, role modeling by physicians, as it was for me, and most of what I learned about pain was wrong. So there is some new learning. You will have to wipe out what you already know a bit and learn something, say, fresh. Let me also tell you that similarly, every symptom will have to be learned differently. I'll give you an example. Raju? Suppose a patient with advanced incurable cancer has breathlessness, as indeed Rani had during her last 2 days. Certainly you will look for a correctable cause. Wait a minute. Is there any pleural effusion? Drain it. Will this respond to radiotherapy? Certainly give palliative radiotherapy. Is there any other correctable factor? Correct it. If there is a pathological fracture, immobilize it. Certainly. But what I will not do is to isolate that person. I know sometimes patients also, families also expect ICU and ventilator. If their patient is in breathing difficulty, that's because over the last quarter of a century, we have conveyed that impression to society that the best way of treating people with advanced illness is to put them on ventilators. Raju, your face is registering distress. Am I audible or am I not now?
You are audible, sir, but in between there was a question about WHO ladder, so that's why...
We were reading it, sir.
So, shall I read it now?
No, now that I have passed.
We will
go into it later. At the end. So, listen, doctors, tomorrow, one of you could be my doctor. I am also likely to die someday. I don't know what I am going to die of. If I am breathless, please do not isolate me in an ICU. I want my family with me. Whoever is available. If I can see my grandchild once more, that will be a treasure. If I can have a hand to hang on to. That will be a blessing. You certainly try oxygen on me if I am breathless to see if it helps. If it helps, it will help in 7 minutes. Don't look at the oximeter. Oh no, I am an anesthetist by training. In the operation theater, I'll be jittery if there is no pulse oximeter. But here, when I am treating a dying person, I don't want the pulse oximeter. I want to see the person suffering and treat it. If the oxygen helps, it will help in 7 minutes. What I tell families and patients is, I'll try oxygen on. Let us try it for 10 minutes. If it doesn't help, we'll take it away. You all have seen patients pulling it away. Sometimes they want it, they grab it. Those are the people who are helped by it. If they are taking it away, it means it's a nuisance, it is suffocating them. Calm presence, explanations. This patient needs somebody with him. If you'll be busy, you're a busy doctor, but if you're able to say, one of you is going to stay with you, maybe a nurse, maybe a nursing student, maybe you yourself, one of you is going to stay with you till you feel a little better. That will be really reassuring. And certainly corticosteroids may help by reducing the peritumor edema, and surprisingly, morphine is the drug of choice in terminal breathlessness. And later on, one of us will talk more about that. But Regina has a question. Regina? Raju?
Yes, sir. Hello.
Hi.
Yeah, please, I want to ask if it says that oxygen only if it helps. So in situations where you are doing oxygen only, but then the oxygen is really not helping, and you don't have the other corticosteroids and morphine available at your disposal to administer at that time, what do you do?
Oh, thank you, Regina. Thank you for asking the question and giving me the chance to clear. Oh, sorry. See, Raju, that sentence must be changed. I am not saying oxygen only. I am not saying only oxygen. I am saying oxygen only if it helps. Regina, you got it? No. Try it for 10 minutes. If it helps in reducing breathlessness, I will continue it. If not, I'll take it away.
Okay, I understand.
Raju, please remind me to change that sentence. That is a confusing sentence. My apologies. Okay. The final thing was morphine. If on another day, we will talk to you about management of breathlessness in detail. And there we'll bring up the role of morphine, what dose to use, how safe it is, and how exactly it is to be used. Go on, Raju. Well, what we said so far, see about the red line, above the red line, an iceberg has only about 1/8 of it visible. 7/8 of it's under the surface. A great person by name Michael Kearney said that the distinction between superficial work and depth work. Superficial work is the easier thing. Okay, you are in pain, treat pain. Breathless, treat breathlessness. But psychosocio-spiritual issues are more difficult, not so easily visible. You will have to dive under that cold water and look for it. No patient is going to come and volunteer this information. My husband doesn't care for me anymore now that I am ill. I want to see my children again. They are abroad. These issues of relationships, the financial concerns, particularly issues related to sexuality. Mastectomy is such a commonly done procedure. Hysterectomy is done so frequently in our country. What do women feel? A elderly woman actually told me, at my age, you may laugh at me, but now that I've lost a breast, I don't feel like a woman anymore. Sexuality is not only about sexual intercourse, it's about a woman feeling she is a woman. It's about a man feeling he is a man. So with the disease, these can be serious issues. Unless you really go down to the bottom, you will not see sexuality issues or spiritual issues. Why did my God desert me? I wish I were dead. What's the meaning of living like this? I might as well be gone. How can I commit suicide? These thoughts may come. And one of the things that you will learn during the course, this is a foundation course, at least the basics of how to deal with this. Not today, we don't have the time, but we will come to that. Raju? Story was a tragedy till the last 6 days of her life. Rani was taken to a city 3 hours away where a palliative care center took her in. On her way, they stopped to buy her an omelette and that she was asking for. And then she was put in a palliative care center where she already had been put on morphine, but it was optimized. She was reasonably pain-free. They knew how to take care of the maggots. It took about 48 hours to remove them completely, but the maggots were gone. The foul smell was relieved. She continued to ask for and got omelette and orange drink. It was she wanted a television. She wanted to watch TV. Listen, here is a 17-year-old knowing fully well that she is dying. And she asked for TV. They brought a television and gave it to her. That palliative center. It was a vegetarian hospice. When she asked for chicken curry, they got it, they brought it, and she enjoyed the chicken curry, the omelette, the Fanta, the watching television. And in the last 48 hours, after enjoying life, even today, after so many years, it warms my heart to think that she got the omelette, she got the Fanta, she got the television, she got the chicken curry. At least for 3 days, she enjoyed life. And then in the last 48 hours, she got breathless. It was relieved, but she was a bit drowsy. And then she died like a human being. Without that care, she would have died like a neglected animal. I told you that palliative care is not only about end of life, not only about death, but during those 3 days she lived. When my turn comes, doctors, whether it is for go live 2 years or a day, give me life. Dr. Evangeline is asking, isn't palliative care only for end of life?
Doctor? Dr. Rajova?
Thank you.
Sir, we lost you.
Raju, can you hear me?
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Oh, I'm so sorry. I'm almost finished. I have run out of time also, right? Yes, I have. I obviously, you did not hear the last part. What I'm, Dr. Evangeline was asking, something about palliative care being at the end of life. Okay. Terminally ill is a vague, loose term. End of life is a vague, loose term. The ICMR document defines end of life as a period, as a non-specific period where death is imminent. It is not, you cannot define it in terms of days or months. It can be months. But what I'm saying is, even if I have 2 years to live with the disease, if it is incurable or even if it's curable, I want you to please make sure that I can live. Living is not just existing. I don't want to die over a two year period of practically spending time in hospital corridors. That's a living death. I want to be alive. Life in its fullest sense. I hope one of you will be able to give that to me when my time comes. Raju, can you put on the last slide, next one? And I'll stop there with that question before you. This is a poem by, two lines from a poem by Mary Oliver. And I have this question to ask each of you. You have this one wild and precious life. Mary Oliver calls it a wild and precious life, certainly precious. Even if you believe in reincarnation, well, that may be as a maggot, who knows? You have this life. What are you going to do with it? And Sunil and Raju and I and all our colleagues are in a business where we find meaning in life in our work. We much, very, very often turn tears to a smile. And that is a precious gift that is special to our profession. It will be a shame if, with that ability of medical education, we still cause suffering and not relieve suffering. We cannot relieve suffering completely. Total relief is not possible, but what we can, we will do. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much. Because we spent those 13 minutes on the initial introduction, we did not get the usual time for discussions. We will see after the case presentation. Sunil, please carry on.
Sir, before the patient's story, there was a question regarding WHO ladder.
Yeah.
So that is WHO step ladder for analgesics. Is there any guidelines, not just suggestions, to relieve pain? Due to I never meet the guidelines, please explain.
So we will be sending you, Raju will be sending you. Raju, you will be sending you them the primer?
Yes, sir, after the session.
Yeah, yeah. But also one more document. I will send you the link. The 2019 WHO guidelines for treatment of cancer pain. It's only for cancer. But many guidelines, I mean, most of the guidelines are common for many pains. That document I'll send you, Raju will send you along with the book. You will get an online book for free download and also the 2019 guidelines for treating cancer pain. And we will also do 2 or 3 sessions on pain management alone.
Thank you, sir. So we will move on to patient story, and then we can take some questions at the end. So today's patient story will be presented by Dr. Arjun, who is one of the palliative care physician, and my colleague working in Toronto Institute of Palliative Sciences. So Arjun.
Good afternoon. I am Dr. Arjun Jayarajan. I am a palliative care physician with PalliMedia. So today we will discuss about a 39-year-old male who, So today we'll be talking about a 39-year-old male who was diagnosed with traumatic cardiopathy with stage 4 pressure sore on sacral region and left gluteal region. So he presented with complaints of constipation since 2 days and pressure sore over bed sore over sacral region and gluteal region and moderate pain over the hip region and urinary leakage. So the history of his illness, he had a history of fall while carrying weight, followed by neck pain and weakness of both limbs, and was diagnosed with traumatic quadriceps in August 2015. He was admitted and got treatment from one of the government hospital and was discharged after 1 month. After 6 months, he developed a bed sore over the sacral and gluteal region, which was of stage 4. And the history of pain over the hip and wound site for more than, there was pain over the hip and wound site for more than 2 weeks. Pain over the hip region, which was 5 out of 10. Intermittent burning type of pain, which was bilateral. And the wound site, the pain at the wound site was 4 out of 10 and continuous throbbing type of pain. Due to this, sometimes they keep the wound open. And he also had a disturbed sleeping pattern and decreased oral intake. On examination, he was conscious, oriented. The temperature was 98 degree. Pulse was 82. Respiration rate was 20 per minute. His blood pressure was 120/70 and all the systems were within normal limits. So coming to the pressure sores, they were warm and tenderness. Exudates were present. Tunneling was present. They were irregular in shape and foul smelling was there. So the history of treatment and investigations, the routine investigations were done. His hemoglobin was 10, total count 24,000. B-cells were 80%, lymphocytes 80%, 18%, and eosinophils 2%. Platelet was 1.6 lakhs per microliter. Serum creatinine was 0.9. Serum sodium 132 and potassium 4. Now coming to psychosocial aspects, he was a 39-year-old unmarried man living with a 65-year-old mother in a rented house. He has one sibling and he is married and living separately and was not at all caring or helping them. He was a manual laborer and was the breadwinner of his family. Now his mother is a manual laborer and she is taking care of him. The main source of income is from mother's daily wages, her pension, and some of his friends. They have already taken over 1.5 lakh rupees from a private finance bank for the treatment purpose. And he was a devout Christian, now unable to go to the church. This makes him very sad. He communicates through a cell phone. He says to his mother, like, "I don't think I can walk, so please don't spend money over my treatment." So his main concerns are pressure sore, his pain, and his financial problems. Now to summarize, he's a 39-year-old man with traumatic quadriceps with bed sore present over sacral and left gluteal region, which are stage 4 with pain over the hip region. Now the discussion points. Do we need to provide palliative care for this patient? What are the problems faced by this patient? And what all can be done for this patient and his mother? Thank you.
So thank you, Arjun. So today we have a 39-year-old unmarried man who is having quadriparesis and has pressure sore with severe pain. So do you think we can provide palliative care for this patient, or can we include this patient for palliative care? So what are your thoughts on this? Anybody can answer this? Yes, Dr. Karpagavalli.
Yes, we need to give palliative care. One thing, because of the bed sores, he is now immobilized, or he is having more pain also. Bed sores are very, I think it was mentioned, stage 4 bed sores. So we have to deal with the pain as well. And he will not be able to move around. So we have to take that part in the physical aspect. And coming to the financial aspect also, because they have manual labor, we have to think on that aspect as well. And he will be emotionally also very much low because of the situation he is in right now. And we have to take care of the family members, especially his mother, who's also going to be really upset that his 39-year-old son is being affected like this. So this patient requires palliative care in all aspects.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Karpagavalli. Anybody else want to add any more points to this? You can unmute and speak.
Sir, spiritual care, because probably he was missing out on the visit to the church, a priest visiting or something like that.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Mohit.
One more thing which I feel is very important is psychological care for him, because I think the very fact that his mother has to go out, work every day and manage his treatment and the household would be a big problem, would be a big load for him. So I think considering that aspect, managing, trying to make him understand, and then if possible, rendering some help from the local community services would definitely give him some help.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Geetika. Dr. Edward, please unmute Dr. Edward and speak.
Okay, thank you. I will suggest it's better to hear what he want to do for his rest of life, so we can make him feel better, feel comfort for the rest of life. And maybe he wanna make a will for his end of life. I thought something like that. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Edward. So anybody else want to comment on this? Dr. Edward.
Yes, actually he needs palliative care for sure. The problem faced by him is actually socio-economic and psycho-economic, both. He's in pain, first of all. His pain has to be relieved. He has to be physically and mentally available for his forthcoming year. And financial status with the help of the NGOs and other family friends, they can be open up a small shop so that he will be interacting with other people and he can be working. And his mother also will be independent with this 39-year-old gentleman. Both can be given in a, both can be settled in the same place, and with the help of a wheelchair or this thing for mobilizing him, we can provide a chair so that he'll be mobilizing and he'll be moving around with other people also. So these are small points I can explain at this time.
Thank you, Dr. Ravindra, for those points. Dr. Evangeline?
Yes, the patient is an identified patient with traumatic quadriparesis, meaning he may not be in his end of life yet, but he can live beyond, he can live more years. But what we, but the reason why we need to give him palliative care is to offer comfort to his condition, the pressure sores, and we need not only relief from the physical complaints or the physical aspects, but we also need to address the biopsychosocial issues, including the spirituality, not only of the family, but also of the of his mother.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Evangeline. So there were there are many comments in the chat box. Yes, the patient needs palliative care. So everybody says he needs palliative care. He needs treatment for pain, dressings to be done regularly, if possible assisted movements. And Dr. Ravindra talked about rehabilitation, moving him in a wheelchair, etc. His siblings can be counseled to help as well. Okay, thank you. So now I would ask, sir, there are all of them agrees with they require palliative care. So can you explain more why he needs palliative care?
Sunil, I am so glad that everybody agreed to do this. Say in a UK or another European country or in USA, this patient would not be on the list for palliative care, because palliative care is for serious health-related suffering. There, this man, after his 1 month in the hospital, after his initial spine fixation surgery and everything, would be out in the community. Homes are accessible usually. Streets are accessible. You would see him in 2 months doing his own shopping in the supermarket. But in countries like India or Philippines or Indonesia, this does become a serious health-related suffering. It is like somebody being condemned to a prison, isolation for the rest of their life. And that mother's suffering is unimaginable. She'll be always thinking, okay, my other son doesn't care. What will I do? When I die, who will take care of him? So these are all real concerns. Doctors, these are issues that we have, our society has successfully neglected, avoided. This man is not visible. Thousands and thousands of people like them live living deaths. I won't say they are living, they are dying over a period of 20 or 30 years. This is something that for us to do. Thank you very much for all the suggestions. Social organizations, etc., etc., all can be done. Once we accept that we have a responsibility to look after them, the rest will follow. Once we decide to do something and once we believe in ourselves, okay, Dr. Regina cannot do it by herself. Dr. Ranjita and Dr. Ravindra cannot do it by yourself. But we will, once we start doing something, some people will join us. That NGO that Dr. Ravindra was talking about may not exist today, but they will happen once we start doing something. So here is a case where people need palliative care for 20 years or 30 years. And maybe there are some things you cannot ignore. If you spend time with that person and mother, that mother is going to, the boy, man is already saying, don't spend money on me. I am wasted. Whatever you are spending on me is waste. Just let me die. That is the ultimate spiritual pain. Spirituality is not only about faith in God or religion. It's also about meaning of life. He feels there is no life for him, no meaning in his life. He is a burden. This is something that we will have to turn around. Can I tell you, just as we use morphine for pain, shall I tell you about a miracle therapy for spiritual pain? Love. The person needs to feel loved. The person needs to feel that someone cares, that he is not a burden, that when Sunil is looking after him or when Arjun is looking after them, they are getting satisfaction out of it. That will be true spiritual care. Sunil, I have only one more thing. Dr. Geetika very rightly said his sibling needs to be counseled. Geetika, have you thought about how you will go about this? Shall I get the brother? Hey, come and sit down. Listen, you need to care for your brother and give him a small 5 minutes lecture. Is that what you are planning to do?
No, sir. I think there has to be a certain level of involvement from the part of the palliative care team as a whole. And it might need several visits, several sessions of counseling, maybe involving a professional. But yes, I think still if the person is made to realize, if the person is made to visit his family and see the kind of distress that they are facing, that would surely make some difference.
Geetika, do you think this man will be defensive? Already his mother is nagging him 17 times a day. What kind of man are you? You don't care for your brother. You don't care for me. Do you think that's happening? Do you think an uncle, a neighbor may still be angry with him? Remember one thing, Geetika, you are absolutely right. This cannot be done with one conversation. But let me also tell you something else. Who is palliative care for? It's for the patient and family. You start by acknowledging the suffering of the boy, the brother. Here is a young man who possibly wanted to get married, build a life. He wanted to do this, he wanted to do that. And all of a sudden, one accident for his brother, all the money in the house is gone with the treatment in the hospital for 1 month. They are poor. He is disappointed. He is suffering because he has lost his life. The first step, everyone, is not to be judgmental. See him as somebody deserving your care. Understand him. Listen, and one day, suppose the mother is scolding him, make him sit down with you. Tell him, listen, Saju. Saju, this must be very, very difficult for you. Life has not been kind to you. I can see that you are suffering a lot. Tell me, what is it like to go through this kind of experience in your life? Tell me about your own life. This I can guarantee that unless you understand his suffering, unless you acknowledge it, unless you feel that you are on his side, your conversation will be futile. He will nod, he will agree, and he'll make sure that he never is available when you visit. The moment he sees you coming, he'll walk out through the rear door. Very often, we get into arguments with the family. We should try to avoid that. All problems cannot be solved. But as Juaria has commented, empathy is also for that brother. It's easy to be judgmental. The boy has lost his life. And once you ask him, look, this must be very difficult for you. And find out what all he has lost. Suppose you say, I see. Listen, suppose we organize something. Somebody said, work with a non-government organization to give him some vocation, not only for the patient, but for the whole family. Suppose we manage so that your brother and you are able to do something in your spare time and make a little more money. Let us try for that. Okay, sorry, long lecture. I'll stop there.
Okay, so I think we don't have much time. Before winding up the session, is there any questions remaining on the first session taken by sir from introduction to palliative care or any other question regarding palliative care? Anybody? So I don't see any questions. I think we will wind up the session. So in this, how can we make other people realize that palliative care is important? The last question, how can we make people realize that palliative care is important?
That question came from Edward. Hi, yes. Edward. It's difficult, a little difficult to achieve with one speech, one talk. Some people understand. You must remember that we have a very difficult job because most people run away. They escape. They don't want to think about ugly things. They don't want to think about pain. People tend to run away. But you will have an army of people supporting you. Those will be the people who have gone through the suffering. One of you has a doctor. I'm sorry, I didn't get your name. Your father is having cancer. Many of you have that experience. In the community also, there are a lot of people who are willing to help. We should not expect everything to change dramatically. You have so many challenges. One day, we will talk about organizing palliative care. Right, Raju? That's one of our sessions towards the second half of the course, right?
Yes, sir.
We will have, in answer to that question, we will spend a day, one session, exclusively on organizing palliative care, including this business of gaining strength, how to get support, how to move forward. Dr. Mohit and so many people who have expressed appreciation, thank you all very much.
In this patient story, we understand the importance of palliative care, not only in cancer, but also in any serious health-related suffering.
Sunil, yes, sorry, will you please read out Dr. Ravindra Bharati's comments? I will.
I actually think palliative care should be given to all doctors and their families, first of all. This will actually help society to know that what is palliative care. Okay.
Well, maybe all doctors have some suffering of their own, especially in COVID times, yes. Next one is from Ranjita.
Sir, in Indian scenario, as we are developing country, which is more important, financial support or psychological counseling?
Ranjita, think of me as your patient. What should you be doing? You should be seeing what is my most biggest suffering. That needs to be addressed. If I am rolling in pain, treat my pain. If I am hungry and do not have food, buy me a meal. If you are thinking, doctor, can you kill me? Sit down beside me, hold my hand, convey that you care, and give me that tender love, which is what I would need most. So it depends on what is the, whether the, what's the person's need. It could be financial help for some people, but it could be psychological support for some others.
So there is another comment. Empathy is what we learned today by listening to Dr. Rajagopal's kind and patient words, healing by speech.
Healing by listening more than speech, Dr. Arvind. Twice as much listening than speaking. Because that man that Arjun was talking about doesn't have people to listen to him. Doesn't have people asking him, tell me about your story. Tell me about what's bothering you. Listening. God Almighty gave us 2 ears and 1 tongue. Listen twice as much as you speak.
Okay, let us wind up this session for today. So thank you, sir, for the excellent session. And thank you all for a very interactive session. Will you please also submit the feedback questionnaire, which Rajalakshmi has already shared. We will see you next on this coming Thursday with the topic on pain.
And let me also support Sunil's suggestion. Do please send the feedback to Raju. That is so important for us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all for this wonderful session. We'll see you on Thursday. So we will need a case presentation for next coming Thursday. So if anyone is voluntarily coming up, that would be good for us.
So are there any volunteers for the patient story for the